Praise. Amen. It's Friday night, and I'm telling you, Jesus is alive and well. Amen. Why don't you turn to somebody and say, hello, good evening to you tonight, and glad you're in the house of the Lord. need some folks that would want to come and sing in the choir, because we got enough here tonight. Come on, y'all. Y'all just come on right now. We can hold six. We can hold seven. We can hold eight. Amen. We're going to choir tonight.
All right.
Y'all going to back me up? We'll say all right.
All right.
Amen. Y'all just make your way. We'll know these songs. I promise. Look here. Got a men's quartet coming. All look right. like to me. There it come. Look all out right. now. Somebody put a little extra bracing under the platform tonight. Hello. I didn't say nothing. Y'all come on up there. Amen. That's plenty of room, brother. Here we go. While everybody's up here, well, some glad morning when this life is o'er, I'll fly away. Well, now to a home on God's celestial shore, I'll fly away.
Because I know.
Come on, give the Lord some praise in the house. Amen. Amen. Come on, Pastor, and if y'all can, if you want to find a seat or whatever, that's fine. Amen. Come on, you can make it. Amen. Glory.
Y'all be seated. We're going to have a choir Sunday morning.
Amen.
And I told Brother Josh, I said, I want a worship service. Amen.
Amen.
Brother Josh, he got a lot of responsibility on him, but he's up for the task, aren't you? I am sick and tired of just having a song service, aren't y'all? You know what worship is to God's work? How many of y'all like to eat a big, fat T-bone steak?
How about a ribeye, bro?
Okay, that's the message, okay? How many of y'all like to eat a big, fat T-bone steak on a table that's got roaches crawling all over it? That's about the equivalent to some of the song services that I've been in over the years at some churches, amen? Let me tell you something. Worship is the table that is set for the main course, for the meal. I'm excited because I thank God I'm in a singing church. I thank God that we've got people that love to sing for the glory and honor of God.
Amen.
I don't like to eat a steak off a nasty table either. I won't. I'd probably just go hungry. That's anything. Somebody set them cracklings like Brother Vernon gave me the other day on that nasty table. I'd have had to turn my nose. Amen. Worship sets the table for the main course, for the meal.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I don't care if you can't sing a lick. Sing from your heart.
There it is, right there.
Sing unto the Lord.
Glory
to God. You notice he said make a joyful noise.
Yes, sir.
Because he knew not everybody could carry a tune in a bucket, but he wanted everybody to make joyful noise unto him. Because when it gets to him, he don't hear racket. He hears love and worship. And I believe God smiles on worship.
Yes, he does.
It's a Sunday morning. We'll start around 10:45 after Sunday school.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
And Brother Josh, you have a worship service. We got a piano player now. Got a guitar player. We got singers. God has blessed this church,
yes,
hasn't he?
Amen.
Come on. We got a harmonica player out there. We got a band. You played a banjo too?
Yes, I didn't want to bring that tonight.
You telling off on yourself. You played a mandolin, the guitar, the banjo. What else you play?
I've got a accordion.
Are you serious? Well, praise God.
He plays the radio too.
I'm asking God to send us a drummer, too, one
Brother
day.
Charles Gassett at the barrack, he'd never get, he wanted to play the banjo, and I showed him a few cards on it, and I got him the banjo, and he went home. And a week later, I went out there, and he sat on the back porch, and then the banjo wasn't there. And I said, Brother Charles, I said, where's the banjo? He said, oh, brother, he said, I can't find the turn on at all. So,
well, I heard that the Cajun man was there at the funeral, Benji Guidry. That's what I heard.
Was
he? Here's a song he sang. It was something about Cajun man. I can't remember the name of it. Y'all met Barry Guidry, right? I know y'all have. Had to. He's a preacher down in Houma. I've had the privilege to get to be in the same meeting with him, and he's very talented, isn't he? But he pastors a church down there. But I was talking to somebody at work, and Brother Dove had told me this before, but I guess it's kind of like the gospel to the ears that ain't ready to receive it. Sometimes it don't hit people until it's time. Well, this guy said that this place used to be a barn. And I remember what Brother Dove said. This place used to be a barn, right?
It was tore down.
So at one time, this was a barn.
Well, yeah, all the lumber was.
You know what I'm reminded of? Think about Jesus when he was birthed into a stable.
Yes, sir.
Isn't that amazing? What a testimony. It didn't hit me until, you told me, then it didn't occur to me till this guy that used to be in the area was telling me about it, and it's like, man, that is a testimony from a place to where the animals inhabited. You reckon God's got big plans for this place?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Humble beginnings. Let me tell you something. That staple was never the same when Jesus was in the house.
No.
Don't you know there was a shouting time going on at some point? I don't think that staple was ever the same. Hey, your staple is never the same when Jesus comes in, is it? What an amazing parallel there. From stable to the house of God. Some of y'all chew on that. It'll sink in about midnight. Y'all slither out of bed and start worshiping God. We need to keep that in the book. That's amazing. That just shows what God can do. He can take something as nasty as an old barn and turn it into a place of worship for Him. He can take the nastiest old sinner.
Yes, sir.
High on whatever it is they get high on. Low on whatever it is they get low on. Drunk on whatever it is they get drunk on. Whatever. He can take them and turn it into His house for His glory and His honor.
Amen.
I'm convinced the best AAA and BBA or whatever it is there is a dose of the old-fashioned Holy Ghost. You got some psychological issues. I believe the Lord can help you with some of them too. Amen?
He can.
He's
got peace to the storm.
Yes. Give us a sound mind.
What did that fellow say when the demons come out? It was found clothed and in his right mind.
That proved one thing. All these people in Hollywood taking off their clothes is insane.
Yeah.
I want to go ahead and...
Hey, before we do that, we want to do something for the church.
You have done so much for the church, brother.
This is a brand new Christian flag, and I would love to see the men of the church put up a flagpole out there,
yeah.
And that flag and this flag is flown constantly.
Amen. Thank you, Brother Dave. I'm gonna open it, I guess, and show everybody. Amen. Can you men make that happen?
Yes.
Y'all just put... They what?
They won't for a long time.
Then men? Okay, somebody can pour the concrete and somebody supply the pole and make that happen.
I got a 7-foot light pole.
There you go. Y'all just make it happen. That's all I want. Y'all just make it happen. Amen. Thank you, Brother David. They also did something else. And don't cut them outside lights off right now. Leave them on. Leave them on at night. I want them on at night. I don't want this place going dark at night anymore. I don't. I want it lit. It don't cost that much to run them lights. Amen? And when those go bad, we'll put LED lights in there and they'll shine. But they bought...
No, they didn't. He did.
That was Stephen's vision.
Okay, well, Bulldog bought us some lights for the steeple.
Amen.
And tomorrow I'm going to try to pick up the transformer for it and a timer. That way the steeple never goes dim.
Amen.
Somebody fold this. My arm's giving out.
Well, you did good.
I had to do something. You folded it. I had to work today, so I'm kind of...
Uh-oh.
But never again will this thing go dim. This church will never go dim. It didn't go out. It just went a little dim for a little while God's people learned... Y'all learned a little bit more about faith during that time, didn't you?
Yeah.
You realize... This reminds me of the military. They'll talk about something for 50 years, and when they finally get ready to do something, they finally do it, and it happens real fast. When God does something, He'll tell you He's going to do it. And in our time, and we're like, well, it ain't happening in 20 years. And then all of a sudden, bam, He comes in, and look what He's done. Do y'all realize in 3 weeks, He has fundamentally transform this church back into what it was, back to what it she used to be. Amen. Y'all realize how fast that happened? I'm just amazed. It wasn't a group. It wasn't me. It was the Lord. He seen an obedient preacher step out in faith, and then he seen an obedient church step out in faith. And I felt in my heart, I felt Lord come bring me here. You know how I knew, number one? He started giving me a vision for this place right off the bat. It wasn't because I wanted to pastor a church, okay? There's churches all over. Churches are a dime a dozen, and preachers, a good preacher, he's hard to find. I can promise you that. So that didn't have nothing to do with me coming here. I didn't just see Anchor and say, man, that's a good place to pastor. I was ready to go home and take it easy, amen? Kind of kick my feet up and walk out, get a fresh breath of that country southern air, and just kick back and then come here the first Sunday. Yeah. Brother Chad was preaching, and I was like, man, the Spirit of God is alive in this place. Mm-hmm. And when things didn't work out, Brother Chad, around that time, the Lord started giving me a vision. Yeah. I could see that place tore down, see a new building on the grounds. This place come spring back. Man. Yeah. I believe God does that. He gives a man a vision for a place and a people a vision for a place. Yeah. I'm excited, man. I'm excited. Aren't y'all excited of what he's doing?
Yeah.
You realize, Brother Duh, y'all be here Sunday morning, won't you? Okay. You realize Sunday morning we'll have probably triple amount of people that was here 3 weeks ago.
Amen. Thank God. God is good.
And there's talk of others coming. We haven't even scratched the surface of what's to come. I'm not looking for a mega church. I'm looking for a church built on the principles of the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And I believe that us being faithful, God is going to honor that with people.
Amen.
And I'm excited because now we're going to get a chance to teach these new babes in Christ the basic fundamentals that we know, and the Lord's going to use them. He's probably going to call people out and send them out as church planters and missionaries, and what an honor. Amen.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
I'm a firm believer that churches produce churches. And, I mean, because what happens if church don't produce churches? You don't have a lot of churches left, amen?
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Not tomorrow, maybe not next year. Then again, if God says,
nope.
I'm looking for the day when the Lord takes this church and multiplies it with plate congregations just like her in these places that need them. I could talk all night. I'm going to let the group have it. I want to have the offering, the ushers come. Man, I like this. Come on up, Brother Josh and Brother Dove. Reminds me of my first church. I just dressed and looked like I normally did, and the next thing I know, amen. Hey, look, I like that. God's going to call him to preach it. Be calling him Reverend Dove. Come on. Let's remember.
I do.
He'll call you to the Philippines Sunday evening when the preacher come by. You never know. But I want us to lift up Jimmy Johnson tonight. And lift up my mother. Lift up the others out there that are hurting. Lift up Brother Bruce. He's been working a lot. I know his heart is here. Lift up the guys as they travel back tonight.
Yeah. Y'all leaving tonight, brother? Okay. I'm going to be around to help you. I'll help you any way I can.
And if we have some other strong backs that's willing, amen. I'm sure very likely.
I think they need to come back in a year.
They'll be less than a year.
If y'all come back in a year.
Well, that'd be hard, though.
Yeah, if we get y'all to come back, we'll have another revival in a year.
Amen.
They have an open invitation to come anytime. Next time you're in Louisiana and you got an opening, don't even. If I find out, you can call me. I'm coming to Magnolia or wherever that is.
You have to smell the smoke and find where it's
I'll
at.
Smell the pig slop, amen. Razorback. But y'all have an open invitation to come back anytime. And I encourage you, anytime you're in the area, come back. If it's a Thursday night, we'll just have Thursday night service.
Amen.
But 100% of this goes to the Crusaders. Where'd Stephen go?
Right here.
How do they send the money to the Crusaders if they want to, if they feel
you
led to support you?
On our website at www.thecrusadersministries.com. As well, if you're here tonight and you didn't bring cash with you, I know most people don't carry cash anymore. We can accept credit and debit cards as well if you'd like to give that way.
We need to do that in the church house. Amen.
Yes, you do.
Just don't give me a credit card, debit card, debit card, okay? So there's you. And I encourage any churches out there that's, I don't care if you're not looking for somebody to support, make a way and support these guys, because they do more than just sing and preach. They also, they preach first, but they also do a lot of, their heart's in it and they're genuine. I want to ask Brother Dub to bless the offering. And then I want Brother Josh to thank God for the offering.
Father, we thank you, Lord, tonight for this offering that we're about to take. And Lord, we ask you to bless each and every one that has to give and have not. Father, you know their hearts, and God, only you. And Father, we pray tonight that these ones that was called out a while ago, Brother Brandon's mother and my brother, God, we lift them up to you tonight. Undergird them, Lord, and take them. Bring them up out of their bed of affliction. God, I pray tonight for the music, for the singing, for the preaching. Lord, you stand, Brother Brandon, behind the cross.
Yes, Lord.
God, give him the words to say that it might touch somebody's heart tonight. Thank you now, Father, for what you've done these past 3 weeks for Anchor. God, we might have once been a born, but Father, when we found you, God, we become a castle, a lighthouse. God, we thank you for that tonight, that we are a lighthouse. Bless us now, Father. Go with us through the singing, the preaching, and everything tonight that be done to uplift Jesus. In Jesus' name we ask, amen.
I was watching some of y'all's faces back there. It's good to see joyful givers. Amen. Go ahead, Brother Josh. Tell you what, go ahead and book me if you don't have nothing for February the 12th of next year, that week. And again, if you come through before then, you come on. Amen. We'll just celebrate my year anniversary next year. What a way to do it, huh?
Amen.
Amen.
special. She's going to make her way up here and sing for us, and I'm thankful for that. And then God is doing a lot of great things. I'm telling you, I'm going to take the time, maybe over the next few days, and try to go back. And I have a little book out there. It's not like a journal, but I write down a lot of things. Go back into that and look at the calendar and relive for just a few moments on what God has done and the great and mighty things that he's done. Just as I am. Aren't you glad?
How old is she?
14. Amen. Amen. Give her another hand tonight. Amen. You know, sometimes a friend of ours, he sent us a message the other night, and he said, how about God on the mountain? So here he come back again tonight. And all of a sudden, Stephen walked over and said, somebody else wants to hear God on the mountain. I'm like, I hadn't sung that song in years. And so, aren't you glad that he's God on the mountain? Yes, sir. But I'm glad he's God in the valley too. Hello. Amen. Life is easy when you're up on the mountain and you've got peace of mind like you've never known. But it's down in the valley of trials and temptations, that's when faith is really put to the test. For the God on the mountain is still God in the valley when things go talk of faith when you're up on the mountain, and the talk comes so easy when life's at its best. But it's down in the valley of trials and temptations, and that's when faith is really put to the test. Let's sing, church. For the God on the mountain is still God in the valley when things go of faith when You're upon the mountain. It's easy, ain't it? Talk comes so easy when life's at its best, but it's down in the valley of trials and temptations, and that's when faith is, it's really put to the test. For the God on the mountain is still God in the valley when things go wrong. He'll make them right. For the God give the Lord some praise in the house. Amen. Come on, Brother Dove. Amen. I'm excited. Sister Shirley, y'all make your way. I'm excited about singing tonight. We got some singing going on tonight. Amen. Amen. You know, they used to have Friday night all night singings. Now, Pastor, I'm going to go ahead and share something with you. You wasn't in here on the prayer meeting this morning. How many of us was here this morning at the prayer meeting? Raise your hand. All right. I want you to look, Pastor. I want you to look at everybody. Hold your hand up. Come on now. Don't be afraid. All right. Now, there was a prayer meeting that was held about taking Navarre. That's Florida, y'all. McNary and Glenmore for the Lord. Surrounding this property and beginning to pray. And I'm gonna mark my calendar, but here's what I want to mark on it. A crusade, not a revival, a crusade, brother, with a big tent. Would somebody help us get a tent? I'm talking about for that meeting, your anniversary. Some other churches come on together. Wouldn't it be something if 1,000 souls got saved? That's all y'all got for 1,000 souls? I'm telling you, with God, what? I think you better say that one time. With God, you're getting closer. Come on now. With God, that's what I'm talking about. So, Pastor, we praying, they praying already. They're going to start driving the area, claiming these streets, these parish roads for the kingdom of God. Amen. And so I'm thankful, but we're going to mark the calendar. And if it's right here, praise the Lord. I'm all in. Amen. And we're gonna mark it. Woo, yee. I'm ready, brother.
Got your attention?
Yes, sir. In other words, shut up, huh?
We're gonna try to sing an old song, Bring You Home. If you save the night, we got a brand new home.
Amen.
And you're going to heaven. So this is what we're singing about, brother, tonight. Our brand new home. If you're all by this world and all its beauty, many earthly mansions daily you may see, but without great wealth, I know you will neither if you're no more rich than me. But if your soul will look beyond what man is building, you can see what earthly mortals cannot see. mansion being built just for me. My new home, but I sit upon foundation. Old man-made hands will someday pass away. It won't be built where the storm of life will batter, off where the storm cloud often hides the light of day. There's a cornerstone up yon in my foundation, the root of David Christ, our Lord and coming King. Oh, what a welcome and homecoming there awaits me. And I'm expecting
song tonight. I guess I'll go ahead and do it.
Because
we ran over, so I'm
going to
do it.
Yes, sir.
Tonight, I want to make you a promise.
Yes, sir.
I firmly promise you I'll meet you across the river. So, if you're saved, you can make this promise too. I firmly promise you that I'll meet you by the river, on the banks of that evergreen shore, where hearts will never break and our lips will never quiver. See them cross the silent river, for they are leaving every moment or two. So won't you firmly promise me that you'll meet me by the river, and I'll make you this promise. We know not when that moment will be, but before we say goodbye and they draw that final curtain, would you make me this promise too? I firmly promise. One by one, we can see them cross the silent river. They are leaving every moment or two. So won't you firmly promise me that you'll meet me by the river, and I'll make you this promise too. And I'll make you this promise too.
Amen.
Okay, brother. I'm going to sing this old song for my brother, because coming soon. Coming soon, Jesus in all his glory, not just a Savior, but a reigning King. She came, now this old world of sin and sorrow, an humble babe in a manger in Bethlehem. But this time he's coming it all.
To come get the church.
Is coming.
See, and I believe that's going to be real soon. Jesus is coming soon. And so, my friend, I tell you tonight, we need to take as many of our friends and family with us as we can tonight. See, we can't let the revival that has went on the services the past 3 weeks, we can't let that spirit die in this community. We've got to keep fanning that fire so it'll grow and grow and grow and grow until it takes over the whole community, until it takes over the state of Louisiana tonight. See, we've got to get serious about the gospel of Jesus Christ. See, this is not the time to be playing around with church. This is not the time to be saying, you know, it's not the time to say, we'll get those people next time. We'll get them next year. See, next year may never come. See, their next year may never come. You never know.
Glory to God.
You never know what is going to happen to you. You don't know what's going to happen to you before you leave this church tonight.
Yes.
See, Jesus is coming soon. Y'all sing a little bit more of that.
And when he comes, he's still by the power of old Satan.
See, I tell you tonight, he is going to trump over Satan one of those days. See, he's gonna send Satan and great bombs. Satan won't be roaring around seeking whom he made a fire over. Right now, he's seeking tonight. God is seeking people, but I'll tell you tonight, right now, Satan is seeking you just as much as God is tonight. And he's saying, you know, you don't have to go to church. You don't have to do all that to be saved. See, Satan likes to tell us all. that kind of junk. But see, as I preached on the other night, when you're saved, you'll want to do the things of God, and you'll want to be in the presence of God, and you'll want to fellowship with God's people. And you'll want to tell others that Jesus is coming soon. See, tonight, if you're here and you don't know Jesus as your personal Savior tonight, I have good news for you tonight. Before you leave here tonight, you can get saved tonight. Your life can be completely changed tonight. See, there's a lot of things that happen to us when we get saved. There's a lot of stuff, and I don't remember how. There's an article on it I've read before. A lot of stuff happens internally in your body when you get saved. All this stuff is changed. As I said the other night, it'd be a shame for people to leave a church pew and bust hell wide open being in church their entire life. But my friend, I tell you tonight, there's a lot of people that will do just that. See, so don't let pride and arrogance get in the way of your relationship with Jesus Christ. Don't let a church membership that you've got get in the way of a relationship with Jesus Christ, because it's not about a church relationship tonight. It's about a relationship with Jesus Christ, because He is coming soon. In all His glory, He is coming soon.
Yes.
And see, one of these days,
one day,
it will be too late,
yes, God,
to ask Jesus to come into your heart and to save you. It will be too late.
Yeah.
And so tonight, if you're watching by the way of the internet, or you're sitting in these pews tonight, if the Holy Ghost of God is convicting your heart to get saved, and I wouldn't be up here telling you this if there wasn't somebody here tonight that's dealing with it. If He is convicting you to get saved, do not leave this place without getting that right. You don't know what can happen.
You know, Brother Stephen just preaching there and listening to him. And I'm thinking about my brother the other day when the doctor come out there and he looked at me and my sister, his wife. I said, well, how long has my brother got to live? He said, well, we don't know. He said, but if you asked me to put a number on it, 4 or 5 months. He's coming soon. You want to get on board now?
Come on.
If you don't get on board now, what if you was told you got 3 or 4 months? My brother's laid up early night with a brain tumor going across the other side of his brain. Sometimes he smiles and happy, and sometimes he's not. I shake all over because I couldn't take that brother tonight. All I would know for sure that I was going to glory.
Hey.
I'd make sure of that tonight.
That's right.
Brother, we can't leave this church the other night and not know that.
That's right.
Because we'll all be the next one laying up there at Cabrini.
Amen.
You just don't know. I know I don't, but I don't want to take a gamble.
Amen.
I'm not going to gamble. First place, I never bought a lotto ticket in my life, and I ain't starting today.
Amen.
I wouldn't win. If it was 10 to 1 odds, I'd lose. Make it better than that, I wouldn't win. But I'm telling y'all, my brother, when I talk to him, he don't say nothing back. He looks at me. He caught my hand, and he turned my hand all which way and looking at it. And I looked at him, I said, what's wrong, Jim? He looked at me and said, nothing. Nothing. I just wonder what's in his mind tonight. He could be here on the pew tonight. Where you'd rather be, up there where he's at or here?
Amen.
I'm going to tell you, get me on the pew. Get me on the stump. I don't care where it's at, I'll stand up. Because one day at Calvary, the ground is level.
Amen.
It's level. And ain't gonna be no big-eyed little ewes there, boys and girls and ladies and gentlemen. So you can have it all. But the only thing that we've taken away is what we gave away here.
Amen.
You put it in glory. It's the only thing you're taking with you. And when He comes, He'll bind the power.
Yes, He will.
Little children with a lamb, and the lion that's going to be something. All the earth will be filled with all His glory. Watch here. No need for crying or all tears. They're wiped away. Amen. Amen. I won't cry then, brother.
Coming soon. Lord.
Amen.
Praise His name. Thank you, Jesus. Coming soon. Amen.
Thank you, Brother Steve.
Yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Amen.
Amen. I'm thankful tonight.
Yes.
I'm thankful that when the Holy Ghost begins to move, that people will obey. Amen.
Yes.
I'm thankful tonight. I don't know. Yeah, you've got a word. I want you to come share with us, and then about what we talked about and what you shared with me about. You know, there's a lot of things that I can't even put into words tonight because y'all have become our family. I shared with Brother Brandon. I said, well, I'm telling you, this morning woke up, it's tough, y'all. Thinking about getting that bus ready to pull out here. Because it'd be easy to stay. Be real easy. You know, sometimes serving the Lord's easy. And by Him telling you there's other places to go, sometimes it's hard to pull off, because I've become real accustomed. I told him, I said, coming in here in the mornings, usually about 9:30, I walk in the doors. I flip the foyer light on, then I'll flip the lights on in here and make sure that just like it's been the cool mornings, turn the heat up to make it warm up, so when we come back in here for about our Bible study and prayer time, we're not promised, by the way. We're not promised that the Crusaders will ever darken these doors again. In this capacity, I'm telling you, the chances are you can't even write the number on a piece of paper. It's so big. But you better know. You better know in whom you trust and believe. You better know in whom your salvation is, because there's no other salvation except in the name of Jesus Christ. There's no other salvation. And as we begin to sit and talk today, and we begin to think about all the things. I can remember, Brother Brandon, I'll never forget your face when we pulled up and parked the bus on that Saturday.
What did he say when he saw this old building? What did he say, brother?
Him?
Yeah, what did he say?
Oh, Stephen?
Yeah.
Me? He didn't have to say a word. I could read it on his face.
Come on, tell me what he said.
He said, here.
Way to throw me under the bus.
Hey, but ask him what he thinks about this old building now, y'all.
It's a pretty good old place, I'll tell you. See, I'll tell you tonight that if nobody else got anything out of this revival, I sure got a fire for God again.
Yeah.
I always wanted to be able to get up here and beat on a pulpit. Not that that means anything, not that that's anything, but that is so outside of my character. And see, that's got to be God. As I said the other night, getting up here and preaching like I have been, that's got to be God. Used to, I'd get up here and I was like, I'd read the notes, and I'm like, and it wouldn't be that it wouldn't be a good sermon. It'd be good, but there was just no fire behind.
Come on now.
And see, it's something I always wanted, and during this revival, I've got that.
Yes,
and so I'm thankful for the 17 people that have got saved, and I'm looking for 18, 19, 20, 21 tonight, and I'm thankful for that, and I'm thankful that God allowed us to be here as a ministry.
Amen.
And to be able to meet each and every one of you tonight. You've blessed our hearts. And I'm going to let you come, for I steal all your time.
You just go ahead. If I was even to try to write down how I feel tonight, there's no words to express what God has done for us in the ministry. To come to a little small church of five people and see the attendance triple.
Yes.
To see 17 people get saved.
Amen.
To see thousands of people be affected.
Yes, ma'am.
And I made a list of just things that y'all have done for us, and some of you don't even know that the others were doing, and we just were rejoicing on how
Amen.
A small church like this will forever be in our hearts.
Forever.
Matter of fact, you're probably in the top 10 churches that have ever given
to our ministry.
Given just from the heart.
Amen.
From the heart.
Amen.
We've had meals brought. Food and more food. We've had meats, veggies, fruits, and drinks, water by the case. We've had paper supplies. We've had perfume and clothes given this week. We've had love offerings given. We've had body wash and scrubbies and washed our clothes and cleaned our bus.
Mm-hmm.
We've had instruments given. We've had red birds brought. We've had doves. We've had guardian angel figurines given to us for the bus. Even wooden crosses in an old lump of clay. Fresh hog and cooked steaks brought.
Yeah.
You've took us in your homes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You've taken us all over the city. You've given us vehicles to drive. But most of all, you took us in your hearts. You allowed us to become part of your church. Longest I think David's ever allowed us to stay at a church was 8 days. So for us to be here over 20 has been amazing.
Yeah.
We don't even go to our home church to get to stay that long.
No.
And we've been on the road no longer than asphalt.
Yeah. But we left the 15th of January.
We left the 15th of January for 5 days. I still have stuff on my bed at home that I thought I was going back for in 5 days. Now it's almost 6 weeks, and we're not going home for another probably week now. And God turned that bus. You know, as us as Christians, we have to be willing to turn. Brother Brandon,
yeah.
You got to be willing to turn when God turns your ministry.
Yeah.
You got to be willing if you're a church member and God turns you.
That's it.
You got to be willing to be a willing vessel when he tells you to go speak to a neighbor about salvation. Another hurting church that needs you just to join arms with them. And that's the way this whole community has been.
Oh,
Think of how many churches have come and loved on Anchor during this revival and supported the prayer groups. We've had 22 services. This is the 22nd service. And 23 services. And if I counted right, 14 prayer and Bible services in the mornings. We've worshiped together, we've studied, we've prayed, we've saw His face, we've worked together, we've cried together, and I'm forever changed.
Yeah.
The most important thing is to know that you know that you know that you
Amen.
Know Jesus.
That's it.
So I said a while ago, we'll never meet it this way again.
Mm-mm.
Chances and odds of that is very little. So our hearts breaks for you that don't know Christ. And we beg you to search your heart tonight.
Yes.
And know that you know that you know.
Amen.
And if do you know Christ, then find find where God wants you and just worship Him. Put Him first in your life and just seek Him out and all. But Chrissy, I love you and I thank you. Thank you for your obedience the other night, just sharing with the ladies and being real. That's what it's about. It's about us joining arms and being real and allowing God to chip off that old clay.
Yes, yes.
And make us more like Him every day.
Amen.
But I do. I don't know how to thank you, but I do thank you, and I love each one of you. And we are here. Our cards are back there. You are our extended family. Amen. You know, so at any time that we can pray or be there for you, we are. Because we want to know. We want to know what's going on in your lives and your families. We're waiting for the call that this one's saved. This one's saved on the side that we know.
Yeah,
we're praying for a husband and a son over here and a neighbor. We don't want to be left out of the loop. We care. We want to know. We love y'all.
Amen. 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 That's just we can't write it all down. We can't put it in a book form. If you've ever traveled, and we shared this with Sister Lahinda, we don't get asked to go into many people's homes. We come, we sit in a bus, and because God has told us that we need to be right beside the church over and over. There's a reason for that. We've been offered hotel rooms before. You know, hey, we'll put y'all up in a hotel. And I said, no, we're going to be here right beside the church. That way, somebody wants to pray all night, we'll be there. Because it's not about how comfortable we can get. But can I tell you, it's how much love that we can share with one another. That's what's important. To lift up. This old world's hard enough as it is. This old world is hard, y'all. And this old world will suck you up like a Kirby vacuum cleaner. And it'll bag you up and throw you out. But my friend, I want you to know something, that we as a family of believers, and when we lock arms with each other and we stand beside each other, and when one's down, the other one's holding the other one up, and when one's down over here, this one's holding this one up, we begin to pray and we begin to seek God's face. Yes. As a family. Yeah. The kingdom, the world is impacted forever. And so I just wanted to share this with you. Most probably this next week we'll be up north of Arkansas till probably about Tuesday. We'll come home for a couple of days. Probably get to stay home for maybe 3 days. But it ain't go home and put your feet up. It's go home and we'll work from sun up to can't, getting things ready to go out. Most probably it looks like that we'll be headed to Tennessee, to Chattanooga, Tennessee. And we'll be up there through Thursday night, then head to Mobile, Alabama, start a revival again on Friday of that week. And then from there, it's just solid run, solid run. You might say, well, it sounds like it's solid run from that. You know, I tell folks, if I can't drive 300 miles in a day, I don't want to go. Because it's about getting where God says to go. So now then, after saying all of that, Anchor Baptist Church, are you ready to go where God wants you to go?
Amen.
I'm going to tell you. I'm going to tell you, your pastor is fixing to come and preach the word tonight.
Amen.
He's going to come and he's going to preach the word.
Yes.
Are you ready to receive the word tonight?
Yes, Lord.
Are you ready to receive the word tonight?
Yes, sir.
Come on. Make the pastor, Brandon, welcome tonight. Come on now, pastor.
Yes.
Come on. Come on as he preaches the word of God. Amen.
I've never got an introduction like that.
Amen.
I thank God that I can't thank God enough. Truly blessed.
Yeah.
I guess I've learned a lot through this meeting too. I've learned what a true revival is. It's been amazing. And Brother David, as time goes, we're going to try to support you as a ministry, as a mission one day. Because how can I tell others, churches, to do it if we ourselves don't? But I'm a blessed pastor. The Bible says this, and then I'm going to get into the message, and it's something just really sticks out. If you look at Hebrews 13 and 17, I'm going to be coming out of Luke tonight. But he says, obey them that have the rule over you, submit yourselves, for they watch for your souls, as they must give account, that they may do it with joy and not with grief. For that is unprofitable for you. And it says, pray for us, for we trust we have a good conscience and all things willing to live honestly. He's talking about the pastors right there, folks, spiritual leaders. And the one thing that sticks out above obey, above submission, is the words that they may do it with joy and not with grief.
Yeah.
Though I've only preached here just a handful of times, so far I've got joy to pastor you guys.
Amen.
And I got a hunch that this joy is going to continue.
Amen.
And I'm excited. I know what it's like to be grieved. That's not good, but to have joy. I'm excited about what God's going to do.
Yeah.
Amen. God's already, I feel like we're probably going to do Bible school this year. Y'all done that in a long time? Y'all ain't ever done that?
We've had Bible school way back.
I sense that the Lord's going to allow us to the Lord is just, we getting ready, folk. Just hang on.
Yes,
the work starts. This is when the work starts.
That's it.
But if we ever stop, we'll die. My great grandmother and Brother Doyle, I think we was talking about her the other last night, said, if we ever stop, you die.
Yeah.
We got to keep something going so we can live. Amen.
Yeah.
But one of the hardest things is going to be to let go.
Yeah.
Let go of, there's going to be times where we can't do what we want to do because we've got to go out and get work this church. We've got to go out and get the dying world. If you don't think Glenmora, McNary, Forest Hill is a dying place where people are dying and going to hell, just take a drive. That cop parked up there off of 112 ain't parked there for no reason, amen? And it's not just speeders. But we're going to have to let go and go out. We're going to have to put our will aside. And we're going to have to seek first God's kingdom. I want to see every pew packed in this house.
Amen.
I have a vision to see them packed not only in, not in 5 years, not in a year, but in 6 months, I'd like to see souls here. I'd like to see that baptistry not having the seals on it dry rotted because it ain't been used in forever.
Mm-hmm.
Never again do I want to see a spider have a home in that baptistry. God forbid. But we're going to have to let go, and we're going to have to grab hold of Jesus.
Yeah.
If you would, stand in your Bibles. Turn to Luke chapter 9. And if I recall, I've preached from this same passage before. But I sense the Lord's given a word tonight for each of us. There's too many ball games being played on Sunday night. And by the way, if your children's playing ball on Sunday and Sunday night, you need to pull them out of it or tell them you can't make it. Amen?
Amen.
Fishing tournament, whatever. I think the devil uses a lot of things to keep us out of his house.
Yeah, he does.
And any time that the Anchor family's gathered and you're part of Anchor, I expect you to come. Amen?
Amen.
But he says this, I didn't study this particular verse, but I actually studied 57 through 62 and then 10, 1 through 2. But then I got to sitting there just a little bit ago, and he says in verse 56 of chapter 9, "For the Son of Man is not come to destroy men's lives." Wow, that's a message in itself, Brother Dave.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
If lives are being destroyed, whose fault is it? If lives are strung out on crack and whatever else it is out there, yes, whose fault? I mean, who destroys lives? Satan does.
Yes.
Old man death is destroying life. Death wants you, okay?
Yes, sir.
And if it ain't for the rapture, death will touch you for just a little bit, but he can't keep you, amen? But he goes on, he said he's come to save, he don't come to destroy men's life, but to save them.
Amen.
Let me tell you something. You can be strung out on the biggest joint there is, but let me tell you something. Jesus wants to save you tonight.
Amen.
You can be drunk as Cooter Brown, dubbed over twice, but Jesus wants to save you right now.
Amen.
And by the way, I better not ever hear any of you say if you don't quit smoking, chewing, drinking, you're going to hell. Don't ever let me hear that come out of any of you's mouth, because I'm going to rebuke you in the name of Jesus. Amen? Because that ain't what sends you to hell. Before I ever get started, let's clarify something, okay? You're going to hell from the because of that sin nature within you. It goes back to Adam. All that stuff may speed up your death process, all right? But there's been a lot of people bust hell wide open that didn't do them things, or that did, but it wasn't that that did it. Why? Because the salvation is not of works, but it's of Jesus.
That's right.
Yes, Lord. I get sick of that. I better not ever hear anybody say that around me again, because I'm gonna give them the plan of salvation and pray they get saved. But moving on, he said, and they went to another village. And listen, this is the average church member right here. Average child of God right here. He said, and it came to pass, but as they went away, a certain man said unto him, "Lord, I will follow thee whithersoever thou goest." He said, "Lord, I'm going to go wherever you want me to." I've seen that. I baptized a couple one time, and I didn't see him, but maybe once or twice after that. I'm like, what happened?
Yeah.
What happened?
Come on, brother.
And we grilled each other. I have a birthing room, by the way, in a church. I take a room and I call it the birthing room.
Yeah.
Where I deal with people individually, okay? One-on-one. And pray they get birthed in there. If this is a hospital has a birthing room.
Yeah.
All right? And I've dealt with them in the birthing room. And they said, "I got saved. Praise God." But then you never see them again.
Yeah.
And I'm not saying they're not saved. I'm just saying they didn't get committed. There's a problem. They're living in sin. And he goes on that it came to pass that and Jesus said unto him, verse 58, "Foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man hath not where to lay his head." So much for the health and wealth. Amen.
Amen.
And he said unto another, "Follow me." But he said, "Lord, suffer me first to go and bury my father." Me and Brother Vernon was talking about that the other night. And he said unto him, Jesus says unto him, "Let the dead bury their dead, but go thou and preach." That word preach, to proclaim. Preach what? The gospel, folk.
Amen.
Stand on a street corner and say it, "Thus saith the Lord," in love, okay? Don't be like some street preachers. They've beaten them over the head with their Bible and they're pushing them away. Preach in love the Word of God, okay? Proclaim the Word of God. And he said, preach the kingdom of God.
Yeah.
And that's the Bible right here. Not the Bible you wrote, but the Bible Jesus wrote, okay? Leave your opinions at home, all right? Leave your traditions at home and preach the text of God's Word.
Yeah, right.
You may believe monkeys have three arms. The Bible may say they have two. The Bible's right and you're wrong. I don't care what Grandma Sally Sue told you years ago, and you just happen to believe it. Amen?
Amen.
There's a lot of stuff we've been taught that was taught wrong because it ain't in the Bible. Therefore, it's opinion, and therefore, it's useless. And he goes on, and he says, and another also said, Lord, I will follow thee, but... I used to hate that word. I used to quit standing at the back door for that one reason. Sally Sue would come back there. I like the sermon, but... conjunction, but... that's a good message, but... He said, I'll follow thee, but... the only time I want to hear that word, but, is when somebody says... I was going to give you $1, but the Lord told me to give you $1,000. Amen? Yeah. And he says this. He says to him, I'll follow thee, but let me first bid farewell to them which are at home at my house. And Jesus said unto him, no man, having put his hand to the plow and having looked back, is fit for the kingdom of God. We need to get fit for God's kingdom. Let me tell you something. When you got saved, you're going to heaven. Praise God for that. But may I say something? When Jesus calls me home, I want to be fit. I want to be doing his work. Going out getting drunk on Saturday night as a child of God is not being fit for the kingdom of God. Playing that one-armed bandit, spends all them fancy-looking fruits, goes ding, 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 cha-ching. By the way, if y'all got, I'll put a cardboard box right here. If you got a gamble, put your money in there. I'll put a little thing on there. You donate every dollar you go to a good cause, missions. Amen? Or to help feed my two struggling children wherever they went. Dear Heavenly Father, I come to you tonight in the name of Jesus. Lord, I ask of thee, Father, that you speak through me, Lord.
Yes, Lord, grant.
Father, may I proclaim your word tonight. Lord, purge me, Lord, that I may be used as a vessel for your honor and your glory, Lord. Lord, I'm not preaching to the people, Lord. I want to preach to you. I want to minister to you, Lord, that you may look down and say, praise be. Good job, my servant. Lord, if there be someone here today, Lord, they're trying to grab hold to the world and grab hold to you, Lord, prick their heart and make them realize they can't hold on to two. You said no man can serve two masters. Lord, I pray for someone here today that's trying to serve two masters, Lord, that you give them the courage, Lord, and the faith to let go and grab hold of you, Lord, with both hands. Bless now the ring of your word and your message. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. I look back at Matthew chapter 6. He says, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. He says, take no thought for tomorrow shall take thought for the things of itself, sufficient unto the day of the evil thereof. Then I go back to the text. I looked up that word follow. You know what that word follow means? It says to accompany. He said in the same way with, to reach. If you're following something, you're going to have to reach for it. Yeah. How many of you is reaching for Jesus tonight? Don't raise your hand. How many of you truly reaching for Jesus tonight? Huh? How many of you are truly following? He says that he came to a village and he came to pass and went away a certain man unto him, Lord, I'll follow thee whithersoever thou goest. And what I see in these passages were these men that were trying to grab hold to the world. Stand up, Stephen. You're the world tonight. You're the world, okay? Grandpa, I'm trying to grab hold of the world right now. And I can't put all my attention on Christ tonight. There's a lot of people sitting in the church pew. Yeah. They're trying to grab hold to the world, folk.
Amen.
And they're trying to grab hold of Jesus, too, and it can't be done.
Amen.
Jesus, when he saved you, you became his.
Yeah,
right. It's kind of like the time if Stephen
becomes my servant. Stephen, I want 100% of Stephen. Amen.
Yeah, man.
I don't want to go on to work for somebody else. He's my employee.
Man.
Jesus wants all of you. He don't just want weekend visits.
No,
We got too many people sitting in a church. They got their old King James, and they get home and throw it on the nightstand next to the Hunting magazine or Field and Stream, or in some cases the porno magazines, and we got a mess, amen?
Yes, sir. Amen.
You think I'm kidding? This is the truth.
Amen.
No, it's the truth.
They throwing it on there, and then they, here comes Sunday morning. They picked that Bible up.
I say, you seen my Bible?
They moved the bathroom girl magazine out of the way. They knocked the dust off.
Yeah.
I'm serious. I've been in churches all my life. I've seen some things. Amen?
Amen.
I've been in several over the years, and I've seen some things.
Amen.
I'm like, good grief, what's going on here? No wonder the world's going to hell in a handbasket. If that mess is in God's people's houses, we wonder. We got a mess.
Yeah.
We can't serve the world and grab on to Jesus at the same time. Amen. We got to let go.
Yeah. Yeah. You do.
He said it came to pass, a certain man said unto him, Lord, I'll follow thee whether thou ever shall goest. I've heard the commitments. It's here. That's the scary thing about after a Bible meeting, Brother Dave.
Yes, sir.
I watched Brother Jack. He packed house. Packed house night after night after night. The revival meeting broke out. Revival meeting. I believe this is true. I believe I'll see all of y'all that log here Sunday morning. I really do believe that. If the average revival meeting, it'd be just like that one. You come the next Wednesday night, it's dead, it's 2 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah.
Why? Yeah. Because God's people's priorities are all messed up.
Yeah,
sure. People's confused. They think they can live like hell 6 days a week and go all of a sudden live like Jesus one day a week. Now look, I work a secular job. What do you think if I walked on the job and I started cussing on the job, or if I started listening to filthy jokes on the job or telling some? Then say, by the way, why don't you come to Anchor Baptist Church Sunday morning? We had a good time.
Yeah. That's right.
It ain't just the deacons that's living in sin, folk. It's God's people. It's God's people as a whole.
Yeah.
We got to let go of the world and grab hold of Jesus.
Amen.
There's not enough teaching and preaching on holy living anymore. We teach you get saved, and that's all there is to it.
Yeah,
that's all it is to it, to get you into heaven. Praise God, you're going to heaven. But what happened to living a righteous and holy God life for Jesus?
Amen. Amen.
You know why I dress up as a preacher? You know why I don't wear my flip-flops and my ball cap behind the pulpit?
Mm-hmm.
Number one, it's a disgrace to the office.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes,
sir.
God forbid. If I ever catch, so I call somebody to come preach behind this pulpit, they look like that, in love, I'm going to take them to the back and politely ask them to remove the hat and put some cheese on. I mean, I'm not going to run them off. But listen, you know why I look like I do? Now, I don't always wear a tie at night. There may be times you'll see me in slacks, and I look good as a preacher. Why? Because I want to look good for my Lord.
Amen.
Because He saved me.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
He redeemed me.
Yeah. He did.
And as a pastor, as a minister, people are looking at me for direction. I want to serve Jesus.
Amen.
Now, what you do is your priority, amen?
Mm-hmm.
But what stands behind this pulpit and preaches the gospel, that's mine. You know why?
I don't go out there and live like the world 6 days a week and live like I live for Jesus on Sunday. Not because I'm scared I'll lose my salvation. That's settled in heaven.
Yeah.
I'm staying with the blood of Jesus. He's covered. It's in my veins.
Yeah.
I can't get that out. I've eternally redeemed.
Yeah, sure.
You know why I don't live like Kelsey phase a week and come in and live like Jesus? Because I want to serve my Lord.
Yeah.
We was talking about that today at work, these total strangers that one of them I hadn't met until yesterday. We was talking about that this false religion saying you're going to go to hell if you don't quit doing this and this, or you got to do this to keep salvation. That's a lie. That's a lie of hell. That's one of the biggest lies that the devil ever told.
But the reason why we do that is I want to serve the Lord. He saved me.
Amen.
Miss Chrissy catches me. I'm walking on the train tracks and she sees a train. She pushed me out of the way. What you going to do? Think I'm going to do for her?
Yeah.
I'm going to try. I'm going to do everything I can to please her.
Yeah.
Let me tell you something. We can't serve God and mammon. We can't. We've got to be committed to Jesus.
Amen.
And Jesus said unto him, foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests. The Son of Man hath not where to lay his head.
Okay.
How many of you would open your door to a complete stranger who was down on their luck for shame? How many of you? I'm saying use common sense. Okay, the Spirit of God gives you, he gives you discernment. Alright?
Yeah.
But how many of you would open your house up? I look back at Jesus. Then I look at these useless so-called ministers living high on the hog, and I'm not against, I think preacher ought to have some, all right? I'm a firm believer the church better take care of the man of God, okay? Don't be like the time I said something about asking people about my milk and eggs. And they said, well, preacher, you want to start paying you in milk and eggs? Don't be like that, okay? I believe man of God ought to be taken care of.
But amen.
Having a private jet is a little extreme.
That's right.
You can buy a plane ticket, go to Africa, wherever, just like I can. Amen?
Amen.
Jesus, I look at him and his example.
Yeah.
He didn't have nothing. He had, though he had heaven, but on earth, his earthly walk, he didn't have nothing.
Right.
He said foxes.
Keep going.
We're going to cut it off. He said, foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man hath not where to lay his head.
Right.
And may I add, if you see somebody in town and they look kind of destitute, don't take them for granted, amen? What I'm talking about, when I talk about me dressing up, that's my thing, okay? I believe that a preacher ought to look like a preacher, amen?
Amen. Yeah.
I believe the youth leader better look like the youth leader, too,
amen?
Amen.
Yes, sir.
And I'm very skeptical about having a youth leader, just to tell y'all. There ain't but one leader here, and Jesus is him. Amen? And I'm his under-shepherd. The church ain't big enough for two pastors, may I add. And I'm not saying we never do it, but if we ever do, I'm going to grill him 9 times 10, and the first time he tries to take my position, he'll be out the door. Amen? But listen. And the first time he plays worldly games with the youth group, he'll be out the door on his head.
Hey.
Come on.
Come on.
We got to follow Jesus, folk.
Amen.
I'm old-fashioned in that sense. I'm old-fashioned in that sense. That we, you know, I want to serve Jesus with all my heart.
Yes.
Amen. I can't grab on to Stephen over there and grab on to Jesus at the same time.
No.
That's what he's saying. He goes on, and he said to another, now as if it was bad enough, he got a hold of one half-hearted follower.
Yeah.
He said, and Jesus said unto him, oh, and he said unto another one, follow me. Again, accompany me. Walk in the same way with me. Reach for me, he said. Follow me. I wish I could get loud. My voice is just, I guess I done hollered too much at that old dog outside at the house. Anybody need a dog tonight? But he said, and by the way, dogs are more committed than some Christians.
Oh, yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Get on that subject for a minute, Reverend. I go home, that fuzzy old thing get up there and want to slobber and lick me in the face and kind of talk to me a little bit. When's the last time you slobbered for Jesus? Huh? Come on now, think about it.
Yeah, man.
Nature itself a witness to the human race.
Yeah.
Let's say you didn't have a Bible on you. All you got to do is open your eyes.
Yeah.
You see, you get the gospel in nature in itself.
Yeah.
That stupid animal will tell you how to live for Jesus real quick.
Yeah.
How many of us are that committed?
Mm.
Another one says, follow me. He says to another one, follow me. Yeah. Tonight, Jesus is trying to tell you, follow me.
Yeah.
You're my child. I want all of you. I'm a slave to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords tonight. Come on now. That ought to make a dead Baptist want to shout twice. I said we the first ones going up in the rapture because he says the dead in Christ will rise first. I've been in some places where they seem they probably are the dead. Amen? Come on. We just happen to be a different group out here at Anchor. Come on. We got the Spirit of God in us tonight. He said, let the dead, he said, follow me. But he said, Lord, suffer me first to go and bury my father.
Yeah.
I'm not telling you there's nothing wrong with going to a funeral, okay? Yeah. Don't go spread that around McNary. That Gil did not say, I've been accused of everything from painting gray elephants white to stealing watermelons out of Johnson's Patch. Amen?
Yeah.
I don't need to be accused of saying don't go to the funeral.
Yeah.
Y'all with me?
Yeah, we here.
I'm not trying to be funny.
Yeah, man.
It's true. He said, let the dead bury the dead.
Yeah, man.
No, hold up. He didn't say, let the dead bury the dead. He said, let the dead bury their dead.
Yeah,
dead. You better pay attention when you read your Bibles. There's a difference. You think about that. As UP Anchor, that's one of the things we're going to, I don't know what all y'all know, so I'm going to be pointing that out. There's a difference in thee and there. And by the way, everything that I preach, be skeptical of. And every time a minister gets up here, be skeptical of what he has to say. Anytime you're out there in town talking to somebody, be skeptical about what they have to say. Don't take my word for it. Go to the Bible.
Amen.
Come on.
Amen.
How do you think Jim Jones led a cult?
Yes, sir.
We had a bunch of followers that took his word.
Right.
He goes on. He said, let the dead bury their dead. But go thou and preach the kingdom of God.
Yeah.
Why is he saying, don't go to this, don't go back? Because there's an urgency, folks.
Yeah.
Before you go in town and you start acting like the world, you better think twice.
Yes.
Because there's somebody watching you.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
All the time. I'm not just talking about the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm talking about there's somebody watching you. I guarantee you, if somebody's seen that 2002 Champion Pala, no hubcaps, filthy as can be, needs a car washing, the truck bashed in, want to back into a nursery trailer, I guarantee you somebody's sitting there, they're watching that car.
Mm-hmm.
And I promise you that if they're watching to see if that car goes somewhere it don't need to be, or does something they don't need to go do.
Mm-hmm.
People's watching. There's an urgency. Yeah. One of the best witnesses is your lifestyle, folks.
Yeah.
That's right. My wife, I thank God that I don't particularly have to worry about her.
Amen.
When she's in public, she just like she is right now.
Amen.
There was a lady come up to her needing help.
Yeah.
Do you remember that at Walmart Moss Bluff? Begging.
Yeah.
They seen a godly lady, her countenance and everything, and she wanted help.
Yeah. What
do you think if they'd have seen her in some of the places some of these people in our Baptist churches are going to? What do you think that woman would have done that day? She wouldn't ever, Miss Chrissy would have never had an opportunity to witness to her.
Yeah.
I'm not talking about the lost people. That's different, okay? You see a lost man there, you better leave him alone. You give him the gospel and you love him to Jesus, all right? I'm talking about God's people tonight. We better get committed. He said, let the dead bury their dead. He said, there's an urgency. We'll meet you in glory.
Yeah.
There's times I won't get to go to some of these funerals. There may be family that I may not get to go to because I'm preaching the gospel.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
You know what death is? All it is something like this, Brother Doug. I'm just going out of town for a little while as a child of God.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you won't see me on earth, but the next time you see me, well, it won't be long. We'll be in glory again.
Yes.
That's what death is to a child of God.
Yes.
You take a long trip.
Yeah.
And within the average lifespan's 100 years, in less than 100 years we'll be together again. Amen.
Yeah.
And less than about 70 all of us, but maybe Zoe and them grandbabies will be in glory.
Yeah.
Huh?
Amen.
If that scared you tonight, we can show you how to get to glory. But he goes on. He said in another one, you mean to tell me there was not one, not two, but three? He said, I will follow thee, but let me first go bid them farewell which are at home at my house. He said, Jesus, he said, I want to go with you, but you know, we got to have a going away party. We're going to have the punch. We're going to have the cake and the pudding. We're going to have T-bone steaks that make you lick your lips just by smelling them stuff. Have a little 81 and this potato. Mm. I got to go back to the Lord. He said, I got to go and tell him goodbye.
Yeah.
Oh, but I'm going to follow you, Jesus.
Yeah.
I'm going to go to a foreign land, Jesus, but I got to go back first. I want to go tell everybody goodbye. Oh, wait a minute. What's the urgency of the soul? Did you not call me to go to the foreign land? Don't I need to get on over there? Huh? Amen. There's souls to rescue. There are souls to save. Jesus is wanting to send the light, and we better go after. He said, and Jesus said unto him, no man having put his hand to the plow and looking back is fit for the kingdom of God. How many of y'all raised the garden before? Huh? How many of y'all used the tiller before? I know Johnson, he used his tractor. You probably used a tractor. What's the one thing y'all do when y'all hopping on that tractor plow and you looking straight forward, aren't you? What's going to happen if you turn your back? You got to have some crooked roads.
You set your mark on the other end. That's your goal. You go there.
You got to be plowing some crooked roads, amen?
Oh, yeah.
Some of y'all plowed some crooked roads in your Christianity.
That's it. Yeah.
You looking at the world.
Yeah.
You looking at the world.
Ooh.
You trying to plow. You looking like this. If I was a lost person, I wouldn't follow. I wouldn't want to pattern myself after some people in the church house either.
Yeah.
No.
That's true.
I don't like a crooked road. I think I got a little bit of that CDO or whatever that stuff is. It killed me when I walk into somebody's house and the picture frames are crooked. This one here drove me nuts for two nights.
Yeah.
I had to straighten that thing. Listen. That was about right. It'll drive me crazy. I hate crookedness.
Yeah.
Let me tell you something. You plow a crooked road, Jesus hates the crookedness too.
Amen.
He looking down at heaven saying, hey, that's my child. What are they doing that for?
Yeah.
They looking at the lifestyle they once had. And they veering to the right. And he says, I guess I better get them back on track.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Get your attention.
I remember a time when I wanted to go home. You didn't ask my wife a month ago. I wanted to go home, didn't I, honey? What'd I tell you? In fact, I called my renters. I said, I'm coming home.
Yeah.
My renter, I told Brother Johnson, I'm going home. Well, I called my renter back and said, well, we're going to finish out school. He said, I'm not trying to, you know, tell you what to do or what to change your mind. He said, are you sure? Well, I called his wife not long ago after this started breaking out. Said, well, take your time. I may never go back home.
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah.
Yep. Let me tell you something. A true child of God cannot help but follow him. You know why? Because one thing I've learned.
That's right.
One thing God is teaching me. I haven't learned. I shouldn't say learned or has taught. Because we never get through learning. One thing God is teaching me is that I could have went home. I could have kicked my feet back.
Yeah.
I could have sat over here. Just enjoying the sunrise and the sunset. Honey, we had some pretty sunsets out there. I could have sipped on my sweet tea, listened to the birds chirp, watching the nasty little dog run around the yard. The Lord said this. He said, you're not going to be happy.
Yeah.
Amen. You think you're happy looking back at the world. and not letting go. But a true child of God is not going to be happy.
No.
I feel like if I every time I think about just throwing in the towel and it gets rough, I don't do that too often, I promise you. I only got serious about once in my life and once in the ministry. But then the Lord showed me, you wouldn't be happy. You're not going to be happy unless you're following me. Uh-huh. You think these people were happy? I don't think so. Again, a problem, we can't hold on to the world plus Jesus at the same time. I think about Samson and Delilah.
Yeah.
That two-bit lady. I have to get off on that all night long about the henpecked man following after the wrong after the woman. Amen? But I won't do that tonight because I'm overruled over here for women. But listen, I don't want to get retarded and feathered out of that area. Amen? Samson, he followed that little lady. He took his eyes off of Jesus, didn't he?
Amen.
And what happened? Ended up being the death of
him. Amen. That's it.
His strength departed. You want to know where the strength is in the church and some of God's people? Why it's departed is they've looked at the wrong woman.
Amen.
They've looked at the world. They've tried to hold on to the world, and you can't do it. You realize if all of God's people got right now, what would happen? Just in our area alone, if all of God's people would start following Him wholeheartedly, what would happen? The devil knows it. That's the reason why he's throwing all kind of things out there. I don't know where the Bible says that we to look back. We're not to look back, folk. We go to Lot's wife. What happened to her? She looked back. I looked at that scrapbook, and I thank God y'all had the happy times. Praise God for it, but we can't be looking back at scrapbook.
No, you can't.
Come on.
We're done.
Anchor back in, that's past.
Yes, sir.
That's open.
No.
This is anchor today. Oh,
yeah.
Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
I was hung up in the past there for a while in my own home. The Lord said, you can't look back.
No.
You're not going forward for me.
Yeah.
Why do you think we're doing some of the things we're doing? We're going to have to stay busy for a while. The community needs, we don't need to let up. Amen.
Amen.
We got to look forward at Jesus. We got to follow Him wholeheartedly. I'm almost done. It ain't midnight yet. We got any Uticas? Anybody in here named Uticas tonight? Nobody's straddling the fence, are they? Okay, if you're straddling the fence, you're liable to fall out. Listen, if you're not following Jesus wholeheartedly, you're straddling the fence.
Yeah, right.
You know what happens? You ride the fence, you hurt yourself.
Yeah.
You're going to fall off, falling, you're going to hurt yourself.
Yeah.
The end result won't be nice, but he says, number one, faith is essential in following Christ so heartedly.
Yes.
Hebrews 11:6, and I read. But without faith, it is impossible to please Him.
Yeah.
First part of that verse. If we're going to follow Jesus wholeheartedly, we're going to have faith. When I stepped out Sunday the 5th where I was, God took, you know the hardest part was getting up out of that pew. I wrestled with God, and wrestled with God that very moment. Then I stood up, and the Lord took my feet, and we went to walking. I didn't know what was to come. I was scared. I was actually, I was scared.
Yeah.
Once I got to talking, and the Lord started speaking through me, I started getting a little scared, amen? Especially when it wasn't planned event. Then the next Sunday, look what God did.
Yes, Lord.
You want to see miracles in your life? Yeah. Step out on faith and start following Jesus wholeheartedly.
Yeah.
I think of Peter and the ship on the water. I think when he stepped out of the ship, it wasn't a boat, it was a ship. It was a river.
Yeah.
He stepped out. He did good when he kept his eyes on Jesus and was following Him wholeheartedly until he did what Luke says. He looked back. Then what happened? Depression sunk in. Doubt sunk in. Despair sunk in. All at once because he looked back.
He had his hand to the plow and he looked back.
I think about Abraham. Read to you something about Abraham. Said 12:1 of Genesis, "Now the Lord has said unto Abraham, get thee out of thy country and thy kindred, and from thy father's house unto a land that I will show thee. And I will make of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee and make thy great name great, make thy name great, and shalt be a blessing." Again, Genesis 12:1-4. Verse 3, "And I will bless him that bless thee, and curse him that curseth thee, and in thee shall all the families of the earth be blessed." And it says, "So Abram departed as the Lord had spoken unto him." I don't see Abraham doing this.
No.
Yeah.
He wasn't doing it. God said, he said, come follow that twice. I did that. I want this thing cut. Angle, please. Put a smirk on there. But Abraham departed.
He didn't know where he was going, folks.
Yeah.
He didn't have any clue. But he stepped out on faith and he said, I'm going to follow God wholeheartedly.
Yes, Lord.
Some of y'all tonight better quit straddling the fence and start following Jesus wholeheartedly. I have been thoroughly impressed with what I have seen here. People putting aside their own interest to come. Now, tomorrow I'm taking a little break, and y'all are too. Amen. Unless you want to come, that's fine. But I'm taking a little breather because next Saturday we're getting busy again. But listen. If we're going to follow Jesus wholeheartedly, we're going to have commitment. These guys weren't committed. Three of them weren't committed to Christ. Hebrews 12:1, "Wherefore, seeing we are passed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily beset us. And let us run the race with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith." And I'll go ahead and read the rest of it. He said, "Who for the joy was set before him to endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of God, the right hand of the throne of God." If we're going to follow Jesus so hardly, we're going to have to get rid of whatever keeps us from following him.
That's right.
It's called let go. Let go of the past. I've had to let go of some of the past.
I look at my children, Cullen 13, Branson 11, and I think back at all the times that I missed work, church. But I can't look back at that, amen?
No.
I got to let go of the past.
Yes.
As anchor progresses, we're going to have to continue to let go. Thank God. One of the things that has got my attention is we're allowed to be at the communion table and nobody drives. Amen? I praise God for that. Sometimes it takes 10 years just to move the piano an inch.
I thank God that we're able to let go. When God's people are willing to let go and embrace change, this is the result of it.
Amen.
You know why so many people sitting in a church have never moved past kindergarten and spirituality? You know why many churches have never moved past the red carpet from the 1960s? They're not willing to let go and just follow Jesus.
Amen.
I thank God we ain't got lime green carpet in here.
I'd have to just say something else. I'd have to say, Brother Dove, I know I'm called, but I can't stand lime green carpet. Can't afford it.
Yeah, you can. Get rid of the mess and go to concrete. Amen. Let go. Let go.
Amen.
I'm looking at all kind of changes already. And I'm excited.
Yep.
Fresh. It does good to paint the walls every now and then.
Yep.
Let go of the past. It takes commitment. Another thing it's going to take if we're going to follow Christ is compassion.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Don't ever let me catch any of y'all going to town telling the drunk that he's going to die and go to hell if you don't please drink it.
God, I'll rebuke you in the name of Jesus. I will in a heartbeat. There's a difference in a and a drunk lost man and a drunk church member, okay? And I'll still show you compassion, but my compassion is going to go to the next level. But listen, we're going to have compassion. I was listening to a story today about that. This preacher come door knocking, and the first thing he did at this guy's house was look at what was laying in the yard. And I said, that wasn't none of his business. You're a lost man. He's out there visiting. The first thing he need to do is point you to Jesus.
Yeah.
Some of my forefathers, nobody of which I know, but some of them I'm sure that I didn't know, lacked compassion when following Jesus.
Yeah.
I'm not saying get all wishy-washy and have this got a love and 1960 fruitcake type religion. No, I'm talking about just genuine compassion like Christ showed. If we're going to follow him, we're going to have faith. We're going to have to be committed.
Yeah.
We're going to have compassion. And we're going to have humility, folks. There's a saying that I felt like the Lord gave me. I don't think I got it from anywhere. I pray it didn't. I don't need to get sued. I don't have nothing to get sued over. But he who lifts himself high up on a pedestal is bound to fall off and break his neck.
Yep.
You go out there toting your Bible. And I may not wear a tie when I'm out there soul winning. Okay? I'm telling y'all right now. Okay? I wear a tie when I preach. I just don't feel comfortable when I'm soul winning in the tie. Okay? Nothing wrong with the people who do. But if I go out there and I have a haughty spirit, then I got a problem. I'm lost right there. We're going to follow Jesus. We're going to have humility.
Yeah.
Yes,
Lord.
You think Jesus would have been able to win the crowds if he hadn't humbled himself for you and I? That word there gets you in trouble in some places, folks. People don't want to lose their pride. These people, you look at the whole gist of it, and I see the one God that they were serving was the God of I.
Yeah.
And the Bible says, thou shalt have no other gods before me. But the biggest false God that people are serving is the God of self, the God of I.
Yeah.
Why do you think that people who profess Christ are taking a boat to the lake on Sunday morning instead of being in God's house? I'm not talking about the lost person. Let's separate that, okay? Why do you think that there's no commitment because people are serving the God of sin?
Yeah.
If we're going to follow Christ wholeheartedly, we're going to have to lay aside that.
Yeah.
And finally, what is the urgency? Why in the world is it important that we follow God wholeheartedly? Chapter 10 answers this. Do you know that? You read right there. Listen. He said, after these things, the Lord appointed other 70 also and sent them two by two before his face in every city and place, whether he himself would come. Therefore he said unto them, this is important. This is why it's critical that you follow Christ wholeheartedly as a child of God. Why you be careful not to stumble in language, in duty, in action. The harvest truly is great, but the laborers are few. How can we be a laborer for Christ if we don't actively represent Him? We're half-hearted. This church can be packed beyond measure. People will get committed and follow Christ.
That's right. Yep.
And it'll not be packed with people who are half-hearted. It'll be packed with people who want to serve Jesus.
Amen.
There's an urgency. Those people, that harvest is lost and dying and going to hell.
Yep.
I don't know what the statistic is, and the only time I'd ever put a clock in this building or ever requested one being there is if it had the amount of people that die every second of the day and where they go. That's the only way I want a clock in here. Amen? As a reminder to remind us that people are busting hell wide open even as we speak.
Yeah.
All these cars pass, they're going somewhere.
Oh, yeah.
I'd love to know how many of them was in an accident this past week, Brother Dave, down the road.
And how many of them slipped into eternity? God forbid that we're half-hearted, and God forbid somebody stumble over into hell and we fail to witness to them or fail to lead a godly life in front of them and set the example. And he says this, pray ye therefore the Lord of harvest that he would send forth laborers into his harvest. There's an urgency. That's why he told the man, let the dead bury their dead, because we got to get out there and we've got to proclaim, thus saith the Lord. We've got to get out there. The world is waiting on us to follow Christ wholeheartedly and to go out there and give them the gospel. When I was in Hathaway, I met several people that didn't even have a Bible in the United States of America. You'd be surprised at how many people don't even have the Word of God in their hand in McNary, Louisiana.
Yeah.
But we're our half-heartedness. Look what it's got us, folks. We better get busy for the kingdom of Christ.
Amen.
Tonight, you've been following the Lord half-heartedly. It ain't too late. You can start over right now.
Yeah.
Brother Dave and them come. Make their way. I'm gonna do a head bowed, eyes closed thing tonight, okay? That's outside of my box. Maybe tonight you tried to follow the Lord, but you just can't get committed. Maybe there wasn't ever a conversion. You know, the Bible said that if any man be in Christ, he's the new creator, a new creature. You said, I got saved at 8 years old, but I've lived like hell ever since. You can't be committed if the Spirit of God's not in you.
Yeah.
Why do you think so many of our teenagers, they make a profession in a church camp or in a vacation Bible school, or they make a profession after sitting in Sunday school, and Jim Bob said, I'm going to go get baptized, and he says, I'm going to get baptized too. And then there's no power. Then they just live like the devil. They don't change. They don't have the Spirit within them. Maybe tonight you're one of those people. You never truly got in. You care no way you can be committed. Head bowed, eyes closed. Maybe are you one of those? Would you slip your hand up and say, preacher, I'm not sure if I'm truly saved. I'd like to pray for you tonight. You said, I've tried. The quickest way to tell if somebody's saved or not is asking about the testimony. They'll throw up flags. Well, I got baptized at 7 years old. No. When I was five, I fell off the horse and something happened to me that. No. I repeated the prayer after my grandpa when I was 12. No. By the way, that age of accountability don't give a number in the Bible. You know that? It may be 8, it may be 8. If you say you got saved, and you can't go back to a time where it was all about Jesus, then tonight you did save you. Are you one of those? Maybe you say, preacher, I've tried to. I haven't been committed to you like I need to be. I'm struggling. I want to get as much of you as I can. I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand tonight, but I will ask you to come to the altar. And you can make a point from this point on that you're going to follow him wholeheartedly. There's been many people that I've worked with in the past that I wished I would have set me out of the example in front of you. I can't go back, brother.
No.
Praise God, we can all go forward.
You
say, preacher, I'm living in the past, and I'm not giving my all to Jesus.
Oh, Lord.
Hey, let me tell you something. You know why they call the past? Because it's past. You can't go back and get it. You can't take back the things that you said that shouldn't have been said. Things that you did and shouldn't have been did, you can't go back. It's history. So let it go. It's the only time it's good to look back, you look back at Calvary.
and remember what Jesus did for you, so you can tell others about what He did for you. But other than that, leave the past in the past.
How many of y'all want to serve Jesus?
seated just a second.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Come up here, Brother Bill. I had a hunch. Angie, that same thing I had you and him back there. They want to come and be a part of the Anchor family.
Well,
yeah.
Glory.
Amen.
Glory.
Potentials to the bags that I don't know of, just to let y'all know, okay? Not just anybody's coming into our family without us talking to them. That's, we have to be wise. But
amen.
I talk with these guys.
And yes, indeed.
And I think all y'all pretty much know them also. Today, your daddy was a preacher. You come here a few times, I think, in the past, haven't you?
You realize that?
What's the mission of the church, Anchor Baptist Church, to accept these? Amen?
Amen. Amen.
Motion second, all in favor? Amen. Amen. Praise God.
Amen.
We got a youth group.
Right.
I said we got a youth group. We got to fix your hearing aids.
I'm all right. I can hear you.
We got a youth group tonight. Got Cullen, Branson. You too?
Amen.
Is Zoe going to be coming?
That
work?
Yeah.
I'm glad God's working.
Yes, he is. He's working.
Amen.
Hey. Jessica says she gets baptized when it's Sunday night?
Morning.
Okay. We'll dedicate that baby Sunday morning too. And what we do is... when the baby dedication, we don't baptize, we don't sprinkle. What we do is we simply dedicate them to the Lord. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
We got a little Bible for them. Sorry. I should have told these two kids to cut that first. Right. Amen. Pray over.
Thank you,
Lord. So we got that is biblical. We got a little Bible already for the little baby, so. Grandma over there smiling. I tell you what, I watched these two. I watched Steve and Ann Hart. I watched her over 4 years. I've never seen her smile like she's been smiling. And I've watched him for about several months. And I've seen him two smile just as happy. Isn't it good when God's people come in? They're just happy to serve God. That's what church is, folks.
Yes.
Looking forward.
I want to open up with the song Sunday morning.
I can't quite hear you, Hank. Amen. We're going to do it, brother. I'm ready tonight.
We'll open up with prayer. And then about 10, I'll be doing my series in prayer. I started over because y'all guys, you new guys, okay? And then we'll probably about 10:45, 10:50-ish, we'll have worship. And the message will come after. Our worship's going to continue like it is. Hey, God, Brother John, ready for the task, right? You gotta follow the Lord. We're going to set the table for the message. Nothing harder to do than to get up.
Yes.
I'm going to go ahead and do this. We'll start at 5 o'clock training class. I was going to wait a week. Let's start this Sunday training class, 5 o'clock, okay?
Yeah.
Preaching the church of this 6, all right? We got to go back to some biblical basis.
Oh.
Some of you other guys, y'all ain't going to get bored because it'd be interesting to y'all too, I promise you, okay? I don't believe in preaching and teaching to one group and try to help all of you. That's my job. Sunday night at 5. Training class. Sunday night at 6 will be the preaching. Brother, I have drawn a nail blank. Jonathan Afari will be here Sunday night for the 6
I said, you're getting lined up.
We won't be resting. Praise the Lord. We'll put it to use in the kingdom.
Amen. Amen. Here's four. I'm going to pull all this out. You want to get it in your purse? It's changed. I made a bunch of it.
We'll get it a little bit.
Okay.
Yeah.
As we get all our feet.
Okay. I'm going to hurry with that.
Yeah.
One day as we get all our feet, maybe we help y'all monthly.
Amen. Take a long
time. Yeah.
And when I go to these groups, we're going to try to get y'all some help monthly.
Amen.
But we also have a card and something for Miss Linda Stuckey.
Uh-huh.
I never can remember Stuckey or Stuckey. I've been knowing you too long.
Amen.
I'm getting.
Amen.
What I'm going to do is we'll have our new church family members come here. They'll stand at the back. And we'll have... Okay, Bulldog's outside dealing with somebody. And then we'll have Penny and David. They'll go to the back. I want y'all to shake their hands, love them.
Amen.
Again. I think that's a good idea. We'll do a 10 crusade next year.
Amen.
There ain't no thinking. We're going to do it.
Amen.
This time, February 12th of next year, that week.
Amen.
I believe God's going to allow us to have a 10. I swore I'd never do one again, but sometimes... I didn't swear to God I
wouldn't
do it.
Yeah.
I can break that one. I didn't technically swear. I swore to my mind. How bad? Let's have that. So technically, we can do a 10 crusade, all right? This time next year, God's going to give us a 10, and we're going to have an old-fashioned hoedown. Because I promise you there's a difference. Y'all be invited, but I'm going to ask y'all come back before then. Whereas y'all have stuck, we've stuck out in your mind, y'all stuck out in ours.
Amen.
Y'all are family. Like I said, God's going to bless you guys.
Amen. He already has.
Y'all go to the back. Welcome to today's your family.
15, so. You know, if you look at this revival week, you look at this, I feel safe to say, it happened at the Church of Acts, but this was pretty good size thing, amen?
Amen.
And it ain't over with. But I want us to stand. Y'all pray for my buddy back there, Stephen. Pray for Zoe. This Saturday singing too, I think. I want you to come and play that accordion. Okay. And I want you to spread the word. I think it's in April. Y'all up for that, right?
Oh, yeah.
Huh? Mm-hmm. I think April's the next one. We'll have it this Saturday. Won't be able to. I'll tell you the police, man. Roscoe Pico train. Amen. Brother Byrne, close us out.
No, man, you ain't talking about the message that we heard last night?